So let me just introduce our speaker for the day. David has been working in Central India for the past 15 years as a naturalist with leading wildlife lodges. He's a graduate in English literature, and still he's always been interested in science and wildlife. He has been studying dragonflies for the past 16 years and has co-authored two books, Dragonflies of Kerala and A Photographic Field Guide to Wildlife of Central India. So without much ado, I'll hand it over to David to start with this talk.
Thank you so much, Kavi. I hope all of you can hear me.
Yes, we can hear you. You can maybe switch on your video as well, David. We can see you as well then.
Okay. Okay, let me start sharing the screen. Okay. Okay, good evening all of you, especially thanks to Nick and Kavi and all for inviting me to give a talk. I mean, it's interesting because to give a talk on dragonflies, it's been my first love. So I've been always been chasing these amazing insects, and I've been trying to document them, and I try to spread the knowledge, whatever I learned past few years through different media. As we have a Facebook page called Dragonfly India, which we have almost over 7,000 members. So we've been doing all those things. Anyway, let's move to next slide. If you look at in this slide, there are two interesting dragonflies there. One is the common club tail and common picture wing. I'll tell you one interesting story how I got into dragonflies. So I'm from Kerala. I grew up around this beautiful state. So when we used to go to the school, we had this amazing game. So we used to catch these dragonflies, and we used to collect the small stones, and we used to put them in line, and we used to make dragonflies pick them. And we done a lot of nasty things. We used to tie strings on them, and I used to make them fly. So that's actually a curse. I mean, these dragonflies curse me, and so. And they literally, you know, I have to chase them and study them throughout my life. That's what I've been studying. So they are they're fascinating insects. Actually, when you want to study about dragonflies, the first thing which comes in, where can you find these dragonflies? So dragonflies, all the dragonflies, they are associated to the fresh water. You can find wherever there is water, go there, you may find these dragonflies. So like there are forest streams, there are lakes, rivers, waterfalls, all this. Even sometimes when you, if you walk through the forest, if there is some tree holes and where the water collected in those tree holes, you may find some very special dragonflies there also. So these are the different habitat you will find dragonflies. And okay. Why do we need to study them, or why I got into these dragonflies? Because they are very colorful. They are very pretty looking dragonflies. Look at some of these. These are found, the one which on the top left, this is found in Northeast India. And I photographed this in Baksa Tiger Reserve, which is one below with a red color. That is got it from Kanha Tiger Reserve. And this is very common in Delhi and Central India. And this one, it's from Namdafa Tiger Reserve. So we have a quite a good variety of dragonflies across India. So, and yeah, they are fascinating. Okay, if you look at their the history of dragonflies, they are actually evolved over 250 million years ago. They are that time the oxygen level was pretty high on Earth, so the size of these dragonflies were huge, almost like, you know, 1 feet over 1 feet, and or some people say they are like a size of a eagle or a kite. And they've been dominating all this earth. And interestingly, this is one insect which didn't change much is in their size and, I mean, the shape. If you look at a dragonfly these days, if you go out around your place into a stream and look at a dragonfly and photograph, it's look exactly the same like probably 200 million years ago. Only thing is their size is decreased because of the oxygen level decreased. Okay, so dragonflies actually, if you put together dragonflies and damselflies, they are in an order called Odonata. So I'll just tell you a brief difference between dragonflies and damselflies. And look at to the left, that is a dragonfly. So all the dragonflies, their eyes are together. Okay, look at this picture here on the top right. Dragonflies, eyes together, but damselflies below here, their eyes are wide apart. And the forewings and hindwings, unnuchalium size, hindwings broader at the base. Okay, if you look at the top picture here, this dragonfly wings, the forewing and the hindwing, the unnuchal size, the hindwing is much more broader than the forewing. But in damselflies, both the forewing and hindwings are the equal size and shape. And dragonflies are strong and robust body. They look at this, they are very strong. And wings spread at rest. Okay, so that's one of the easy way to, you can identify when the dragonflies sit somewhere, they actually stretch the wings. But dragonflies, they always fold the wings along the body. And they are strong and agile flyers, all the dragonflies, and damselflies, comparatively weak flyers. And always keep an eye on these eyes. Eyes are joined together for dragonflies, damselflies. They are widely separated. Okay, we'll just look into a few structural difference of the dragonflies and damselflies, because when we go through some of other slides, we need to know the difference now. Okay, so like other insects, I mean dragonflies, the divided body is divided into three parts. One is the head, then the thorax, and the abdomen. Even the abdomen, it's divided into 10 different segments. So that's one of the reasons they can actually bend their abdomen, and they have two pairs of wings and powerful legs. And same with the damselflies. Okay, they have 10 segments. Okay, here one thing we need to remember. I'm just pointing my cursor here. Can you see? So this is the first segment, second segment, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, and 10th segment. These are the 10 segments. So all the dragonflies, especially male dragonflies, they'll have on the second segment, there's a bulge. Can you see this bulge here? So that's a secondary genitalia there. So dragonflies are actually the only insects in the world, they have two sets of genitalia. And this is the secondary genitalia here. And the last segment, the 10th segment, they have that's where they keep the sperm. I'll come to that. And so if you look at this picture here, this is, you can see the male, you can see the bulge here. The female, they don't have a bulge. And this is again a female damselfly. See, the bulge is not here, but in the tip of the, the tip of the tail, actually there is a bulge here. So these are the way you can actually differentiate the male and female difference of dragonflies. Okay, we learned that dragonflies, they are very strong flyers, and damselflies, they are very weak flyers. Dragonflies, when they sit, they stretch the wings, and damselfly, they fold the wings along the body. They have a very robust body for the dragonflies, a weaker body for the damselflies. But we have a very interesting intermediate species, a relic dragonfly up in Himalaya. It's called Epiphlavia laevulavi. And interestingly, this dragonfly, actually, it's got a dragonfly body, and the wing is a damselfly wing. So that's why it's only three species found in the world. And one of them found in foothills of Himalayas. I remember I went to the Goom Valley in Darjeeling. Just to search for this. That's where it's described, this species. And it's interesting because this one species is, like I mentioned, all the dragonflies, they lay eggs in the water. They have a larval stage. It's called the nymphal stage. Then it's become an adult dragonfly. So this dragonfly, interestingly, when they lay eggs in those cold streams up in Himalayan foothills, and their larvae is known to spend over 10 to 12 years, 11 years in the water. So they have around 10 to 12 different molting stage also. So all this, what you see here, these are all the larvae. So imagine an insect spending their life, half of or the 90% of their life in the water. So when they come out, they probably live for a few months and they'll die. But the larvae actually spend a lot of time in the water. So this is, remember this dragonfly, it's I don't know where to put it. Is it a dragonfly or damselfly? It's a dragonfly with a damselfly wing. And only three species found in the world. One is in Himalayas. Okay. And if you look at this picture, I mean, I mentioned that dragonflies, when they sit, they stretch the wings. But look at this damselfly. This is actually a damselfly. They're stretching the wings. But how do we differentiate between a dragonfly and a damselfly? So look at the eyes here. So the eyes are actually widely separated, and but the wings are damselfly wings only. So this is one family. It's called the Lestidae family. Damselflies, most of these damselflies actually spread the wings along the body. And here is the antlion fly and owl fly. People always confuse these two things as a dragonfly. I mean, we always get this. Sometimes people send us pictures saying, what is it? Is it a dragonfly? And so all the dragonflies, they lay eggs in the water. But these antlions and all, you must have seen on the ground, they make these small pits and they'll trap all the ants. So that's how antlions, the larvae stays in the ground. But and also another easy way to differentiate from dragonflies, look at, they actually got antennae, very long antennae, even the antlion and the owl fly. So it's an easy way to differentiate. Okay, so dragonflies and damselfly, they put together, they are called the odonates. So odonates in India, we have around 493 species, around 19 different families. And in the world, it's around 6,383 species. And we have a very pretty good diversity. And I think there's a recent paper is coming up soon, in a few weeks, I heard. So our number is going to be above 500. And also, there is a lot of species yet to be described. If you do proper studies in Northeast India, even parts of Western Ghat, all those areas, there are quite a few species are yet to be described. One amazing thing about these dragonflies, all the dragonflies, they have these compound eyes. And this is one of the eyes, zoomed in these eyes. And these are called the compound eye, each compound eye. They have over 30,000 ommatidae. Ommatidae means they are act like a small, tiny eyes. They are like small lenses. Interestingly, when we can actually, human, all people can see three different colors. I mean, it's like red, blue, and green. I mean, even butterflies, they can see a little bit more. Other insects, they can see a few more colors. They can see ultraviolet and all. But dragonflies, they can see over 13-14 variety of spectrum of colors. And that's one of the reason, and their eyes are so powerful. When they fly, they have an interesting thing called the motion camouflage. When they fly, and they can actually approach the insects without knowing. And their wings also, all the wings are attached to the, it's separately attached to the muscles. So they can beat the wings separately. Unlike butterflies and other insects, when they flap the wings, all the wings go together. But in dragonflies, they can flap their wings separately. So that these are the reasons they can easily catch the prey. And also, suppose if we see if somebody shoot a bullet, when we see, we can't see, it just fly. But if a dragonfly see it, it's probably, it sees like, you know, a slow motion video it's going. So that's why their eyes power. We move to next. Okay, so this is a small illustration of dragonfly's life cycle. So all the dragonflies, when they mate, after they'll come back to the water. So they lay eggs. So the eggs become a larva. Larva, they spend, like I mentioned, a few dragonflies spend a few months to a few years, and damselfly for a few weeks to a month. And when they emerge into an adult dragonfly. So they don't have a pupal stage. Unlike the butterflies, we know they lay eggs, they become a larvae, they become a pupa, and it's become an adult butterfly. So that is called the complete metamorphosis. But in case of dragonflies, when they lay eggs, it's become a larva. Larvas, it's also called the nymphal stage. So eventually it's become an adult dragonfly. So this is an incomplete metamorphosis. So all the dragonflies to lay eggs, they have to come back to the water. Okay, this is probably the most fascinating thing about dragonflies. If you go and visit nearby your place, if there is a pond or a lake or a river stream, you may see early morning itself when there is a light, all these dragonflies are occupying all these areas. So most of these dragonflies, they are all territorial. Almost all the dragonflies are territorial. So they'll come early morning, especially the male dragonflies. They'll come and perch in particular area. They'll sit and find a place. And they'll wait for the females. So they don't let any other males in their own species come close to their area. They'll start chasing those dragonflies. And when the female come, they'll actually catch the females by its neck. Can you see? It's actually holding here. So then some amazing thing happened. So here, the next picture, what you see here, in dragonflies, like I mentioned, let me go back to this this slide. If you look at it, I mentioned this in the second genitalia, there is a bulge here. So that is for the males. And the male also on the 10th segment, they have another genitalia. Okay. So what's happening here? All these male dragonfly, they actually keep the sperms here on the 10th segment. And after it's catch the female, it's actually, transfer the sperm from 10th segment to second segment. So interestingly, the second segment, that secondary genitalia is a very interesting organ. It is only in the dragonflies has that organ. And also it's act like, you know, it can actually, once it mated, and the next thing is they actually goes into a wheel formation, which is like a love morph. And they actually known to remove any previous, suppose if the female is mated with some other dragonflies, this male will be able to remove those sperms and all those eggs, and he can deposit his own sperm. So it's amazing how they manage. This is probably the only insects in the world which does this. And after this mating, which is called wheel shape, and the females start laying eggs straight away. So most of the time, there's quite a few the way they lay eggs. It is a exophytic oviposition. I mean, they'll actually go there on the top of some water weeds and plants and all. They start laying eggs there directly. But some other damselflies and a few dragonflies also, they actually, what they does is they actually go and sit in the plant, and they actually start injecting the eggs inside the reeds or the plant. And so that, the eggs are, you can survive, the survival rate is more. And if you look at one dragonfly on the top right and lower right here, and the tip of here, it's actually the orange dot what you see here. These are actually a clutch of probably thousands of eggs in one clutch. That is one interesting dragonfly called the micrographus. What they do, the female is, it's adapted in such a way that they all pull out all their eggs together and just drop it at one go. So that's the way they lay eggs. Okay, so once they lay eggs, they become larvae. So this on the top, these three are dragonfly larvae. These in the below is all the damselfly larvae. So when they are larval stage, they mainly feed on mosquito larvae and other whatever they can feed on. When they're adult, they largely again feed on adult mosquitoes. And I used to rear all these dragonflies. It was amazing to watch them, how they're ferocious predators. They eat whatever they can. And this is one interesting thing happened a few months back when I was in Tadoba. So I was photographing this particular dragonfly. It's called the golden dartlet. Interestingly, once the dragonflies, all this the tip of the tail, it's actually called the anal appendage. When they hold the female, it's like a lock and key mechanism. So if the female is cast, the male is cast the female won't be able to get out. If it's some other species, it would be, but if it's the same species, it won't be able to get out. So the moment the male started, caught the female, it started mating. Suddenly I saw this big dragonfly. This is called the ground schema female. It came and caught the golden dartlet, and it started feeding on this dragonfly. So without knowing, there is a female actually holding on to the male's tail. I mean, it's sad to watch because they've been trying, the female was literally trying to shake off, she was helplessly flapping her wings, but she was literally locked into the male's lock. So eventually the dragonfly ate both the male and the female. Okay, so this is that the anal appendages, what I mentioned. So all these dragonflies and damselflies, they have a superior, this white thing here, what you see, this is a superior anal appendages, lower this one is inferior anal appendages. So each species, it's a different. This is one of the key identification also. Some of the species, if you want to properly identify, you need to look into all these details of these dragonflies. So imagine if this dragonflies catch hold of his female, she won't be able to come out because of, it's like a lock and key system. So this is a dragonfly anal appendages, male, and this is the female, and this is a damselflies anal appendages, and this is a female. So you can actually know the difference. So like I mentioned here, there's a bulge here, so that's a female. I mean, dragonfly got three sets. I mean, damselflies got four sets. On the top, there is two. Below, there is two more. So total four. Here, one, two, three. So anyway, we'll move to the next slide. I used to catch these dragonflies larvae, and I used to rear them. So a lot of interesting thing happened. So it's, look at this. This look like a drab color, you know, without any features. These are the dragonfly larvae which lives in the water. And sometimes they spend a few weeks. Small damselfly, they spend a few weeks. Some dragonflies, they are known to spend a few years also. This one I collected, they have around 10 to 12 different molting stages, one day instar stages. So when they get to the final instar stage, you can actually see they start developing the wings. So this is one way if you want to collect some dragonfly larvae and rare and study and all. So please try to collect the last instar larvae and put it in a small box, and you know, but make sure you're feeding them with some tadpoles or some other insects and all. So I saw this one day. I used to see them, you know, they every day they actually, I used to put a mosquito net there and I could watch them. But a few days I've been waiting, but I could, in the morning when I wake up, the dragonflies will be already emerged. So I said, I need to watch. So one day I saw this dragonfly, a large dragonfly sitting on the water, and it just started climbing onto the top of a log. So it climbed onto a log and a rock here. It was waiting there. Then around after 2 o'clock at midnight, it started emerging. It was amazing. They actually climbed on, I put up a stick there. It's climbed onto a stick. It started opening from the top of the head. It started coming out. This is the stage. Then it just completely come out. This is one interesting thing. When they come out from this larvae, thing, nymph, they come out and within a second, the tail will come out, and at the same time, they'll jump back and catch the exuvia. They'll wait there. So this is their wing. Their wings are, they'll wait till early morning to the wing to dry out. Then only they can fly out. So this is that thing. They're still drying its wings. So once the wing is dried out, it's completely, it's look like that. They'll eventually, after a few days, they'll get their actual proper colors. So you think why I put up a frog picture here? So, I mean, we know that frogs are, they have an amphibious life for laying eggs or to breed. The frogs have to go back to water. So interesting thing about dragonflies, when they lay eggs, they actually lay eggs in the water. And to come out from the larvae, they have to climb into a rock or a stone, whatever the surface. So they have to come out into the earth. And eventually when they become an adult dragonfly, they can fly. So the dragonflies actually belong to the water, earth, and the sky or the air. So that is probably only insects in the earth which they have, they can dominate all these three land. Okay, I'm just coming back to the identification of some of the dragonflies. Especially before that, we'll make sure we can all identify at least the male and female dragonfly. Okay, if you look at this picture here on the top left, it is a damselfly, and damselflies, like I mentioned, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 segment. And the second segment, can you see a small bulge here? The same thing, this is a female damselfly, and the second segment, there is no bulge here. Okay, but at the same time, on the 10th segment, 9th and 10th segment, there is a bump here. Can you see that? So this is the way you can identify, see that, a dragonfly. The second segment, there is a bump here. and that is the secondary genitalia. It's very prominent here, and female don't have that. Okay, I just zoomed in these two. Okay, now if you can, Kavi, if you can just open the chat box, I just want if people can identify this is a male or female.
Okay.
What is this? Can anyone come to the chat box and say, is it a male or a female? Okay, you have to tell me why it's a female also. And what is it? If it's a dragonfly or a damselfly, why? Everyone is saying female, okay. Okay. Yeah. Absolutely right. Okay. Some people have started identifying a species. No secondary genitalia on second segment. Okay. Got it right. Okay. Let's go to the next picture. Let's see if you crack. What is this? Is it a male or a female? This dragonfly. Okay. You have to give me the reasons why it's okay. Sherry Chandra saying it's a male. She was saying it's a female dragonfly. Yes. And any other answers? You guys want to try more? Male, three anal appendages. Sherry saying, okay. Female, Aman is saying female, female. Sautri saying female. Okay, give me the reason also why it's female. Okay, other reason I'll give you, the male and female, most of 99% dragonflies, the male is brightly colored, female is drab colors. Yeah, so Parthsani is saying male. Okay, we got a mixture of, most of the people got it right, but quite a few people said it's a male. Actually, it is a female. So one of the reason we can identify when you get a picture like that, it is horizontally sitting away. And okay, if you look at here on the tip of this tip of the tail, you can see actually the anal appendages is widely divided. I'll go to the next picture, then I'll come back here. Okay, look at this. This is the male dragonfly. This is a Kamasinghe jayajanchya. This is found in central India. So this is actually a male. The previous one, what I showed, this is a female. So the difference is this one actually got a shorter anal appendages, and it's a wide. It's much more wider than the male. See the male? It's actually almost see. It's joined, almost joined together, but the female is, it's wide. Okay, let's try a few more then. Let's see if you'll get it or not. What is this? What is the top left and bottom right? I request all the dragonfly guys don't replay. I can see quite a few guys. Left is a female, right is a male. Okay. Top left is a male. Okay. Left is a male. Other one is a female. Unnikrishnan. Okay. This is actually a very tricky species. So just remember before randomly identifying by the color size, quite a few people are getting it wrong. And yeah, even this thing, top left is a male, left is female, right is male. One second, let me go back to the. Okay, so, it's quite a few people got it right and quite a lot of people got it wrong also. So this is one dragonfly. It's called the common picture wing. It's one of the brightly colored dragonfly. It's found throughout India. Interestingly, there's a lot of people confuse this as a butterfly also. I mean, I also used to think before I started studying it's a butterfly. So this dragonfly is known to congregate in big groups and fly, especially in, if you go to the backwaters of Kerala, you'll see them flying in large numbers. Okay, so this is a female. Interestingly, the female is more colorful. The left top is the female and the right one is the male. The female is more colorful. So how do you differentiate then the male and different female? If you look at the tip of the tail, it's actually the anal appendages is not long here and it's wide here. One, first and second, it's widely divided. And but here it's more pointy and long. So remember this, when you see next time, if you get a picture like that, always try to zoom in and try to identify it. Okay, let's try one more. What is this? Is it a dragonfly and a damselfly? Okay, dragonfly, damselfly. Male or female? I just want to know male or female. Yeah, it's a damselfly for sure. If it's a male or a female. Okay. I got quite a few females and one male. Isn't he saying male? Vishnu is saying male. Savitri is saying male. Premchand saying female. Dr. Kiran saying female. Any other? Okay, so this is actually a tricky one. It's a female. Seems like a male inferior. Abhishek saying seems like a inferior appendages. Okay, Josne is saying female. Yeah. So it's actually a female damselfly. It is actually very similar to its male. There's a damselfly called a golden dartlet. So the golden dartlet, I don't know how to show a male picture. The male look exactly the same. Interestingly, so what you have to look for it, the second segment, there's no bulge here. And also if you look carefully, the female, there is got a tip of it. There's a small bulge here. So it's a female. So this morph actually, in dragonflies and damselflies, there's a lot of them actually mimic the males. Because all the females, numbers are usually less. And all the males are usually harass them because suppose if there's a female there, one male will come and catch her and try to mate with her. And after a few minutes, another male will try to come and catch. So this is one way to get away from the male, behavior which is chasing the females. So the females will have exactly the same color. So these are called andromorph, which mimic the male dragonflies. It's very common in dragonflies and damselflies. Okay, what is this? Is it a male or a dragonfly? Or a female dragonfly? Okay, I think most of you are getting it right. Yeah, it's male. Yeah, this is dragonfly male, this is bulge. I think all of you got it. So. This is actually a dragonfly called Cyclogomphus, a genus which is found in Western Ghat, few species found in Northeast also, and one or two species found in Central India. So it's actually, I think everyone got it right. It is a male dragonfly because the second segment, it's actually got a bulge. It's easy way to identify. Okay, I think now we sorted with most of, okay, what is this? Is it a dragonfly or a damselfly? Is it a male or a female? One more question. I think this is the last one for identifying the male and female. Let's see how many of you get this right. Okay. Somebody saying spread wing, damselfly, female damselfly. Why it's a female damselfly? Eyes apart, okay, Arkesh, you're right. It is a damselfly, but this family, it's not the spread wing lestes, but yeah, eyes are apart. I think now you're sorted, at least now all of you will be able to identify the male and female difference and a dragonfly and a damselfly. This is also a female damselfly, I'll quickly skip this. Okay, there are a few family, let me introduce some of the family of dragonflies in India. We have Cinlestidae. So this is actually a particular family of dragonflies, mainly found up in Himalayan foothills and Northeast India. There are large spread wings, damselflies with a open wing. And if you're traveling to any Northeast India and foothills of Himalayas, please keep a lookout for this damselfly. And another family, it's called Lestidae. Lestidae are called the spread wing. Most of these damselflies, when they sit, eyes are widely divided. So it's a damselfly. When they sit, they spread the wings. That's why it's called the spreading or the flaccid. But also there is another genus of damselfly. They call Indolestes. They are false spreading. Actually, they don't spread the wings, but when they sit somewhere, they actually fold the wings along the body. They don't spread the wing. So that's why they are not lestes, they are Indolestes. And we have a Platysticidae. These are damselflies which found on the top of foothills of Himalayas and also quite a lot of them in Western Ghats. These damselflies actually very interesting. They prefer to live on the undergrowths or well-wooded place next to the streams. Especially they are restricted to the streams. And Calopteridae, this is found in Himalayas. And we have a Chloroseiphidae. So these damselflies actually very, very pretty looking damselflies found in Northeast India. It's there in Himalayan foothills. It's there in Central India. It's there in Western Ghats. And interestingly, this all the damselflies, I mean, if you look at it, the legs, actually, they got a very long legs. And the most of these damselflies, the inside the legs, they actually got a white marking. So what they does, I mean, when they fly, they try to attract the females. And also, if there is a rival male around, they literally go and start boxing with their the legs. So we've seen them quite a few times. They actually literally go and fight with these other males. So you see these two boxers with wearing a white boxing gloves and start fighting. So that's one of the amazing things to watch them. And also, they are very pretty, very colorful, widely distributed all across India. And another family, it's called the Euphidae. Very colorful damselflies. They found in a few species in Western Ghats and a few in Northeast India and foothills of Himalayas. And okay, they're pretty. There's a few questions are coming up. Probably I'll take it in the end of the say. Okay, there is another. This is one of the most widely distributed and damselflies. They are everywhere. If you go to Delhi, you will see this family of damselflies. They are usually found in around the marshes or large lakes or rivers, streams, everywhere. But they especially prefer all the swamps and all. Another family, Echinidae. These are large bodied and very fast flying dragonflies. They are also known to fly across continents, and they are known to migrate a lot. Another family, they are called the Gomphidae. Quite a variety of dragonflies are found in this family. This is one of the most common hooktail found widely across India. And if you come to Western Ghats or if you go to Northeast India, you will see a lot of genus found, different genuses. There are quite a lot of species also new to science. Another one, Macromedae. So this Macromedae, interestingly, all these dragonflies, they are brightly colored, especially their eyes are brightly colored, their thorax and their abdomens are all brightly colored. And they are highly seasonal. All these dragonflies, especially just before the monsoon time and just after the monsoon, also a few months, you may be able to, find these dragonflies. After that, they'll disappear. This is again a most common family of dragonflies. They are called the skimmers or moss skimmers. There's a lot of species found widely distributed across India. If you go to any lakes or any rivers around your place, you will find a family of this dragonfly. Okay, now look into some of the common dragonflies and some interesting ones around your places. These four species are probably the most widely distributed species. One is called the crimson marsh glider on the top left, which is a pink colored dragonfly. Even the wings are pinkish in color. The females are brownish with the tip of the wings are usually got a brown patch. And it's widely distributed in India, especially they prefer streams, rivers, and good water wherever. And another one, the ground skimmer, again, widely distributed all over India. If you go to Delhi or Central India and Northeast India, all over you see this dragonfly. And they prefer to sit on the ground. That's why they are called the ground skimmers. Again, orange-tailed marsh tart, widely distributed in India. It's there in Northeast India. It is there in Central India. It is there in South India. And another one, the common, the green marsh hawk. those who are observed dragonflies, I mean, this is one dragonfly, you must have seen it all over around your place. So this dragonfly, actually a very ferocious dragonfly, this dragonfly known to feed on other dragonfly. And sometimes we've seen them, they feeding on their own males and females. They don't mind to catch it. And I think they probably 70-80% of the diet is other dragonflies. They're all cannibal. We have another very fascinating dragonflies. They are called the wandering gliders or the glob skimmers. This is one dragonfly is actually known to migrate in India. Okay, a few things to remember to identify this dragonfly. This dragonfly actually got a red abdomen. It's easy, and the female usually got a brownish. But easy way to identify when you get a picture of this dragonfly, always look the hind wing. If you take a picture and enlarge the picture, tip of the hind wing actually got a brownish patch. This will have all the dragonfly, all the pantala, all the wandering gliders and glob skimmers will have a hind wing, will have a brownish patch. Next time, check out that. And also this black patches on the abdomen is very, very peculiar. So what happened with this dragonfly? This is one of our friend took this from a cold wetland in Kerala. So when they're doing a dragonfly survey, they saw thousands of dragonflies flying there. And this one interesting thing happened. I mean, this dragonfly, this wandering glider, widely distributed across the globe. I mean, it's there in Africa, it's there in India, it's there in Australia, it's there in most of the oceanic island around tropics. So what happened in India, this dragonfly follow rain, the monsoon. So in India, we know that we have two rain. One is the southwest monsoon and the northeast monsoon. So what happened in southwest monsoon in May, March, May, and June, we'll get the southwest monsoon first week of June in Kerala. So before that, there's actually a wind current, a trade wind current, which brings in all the moisture to India. With the help of those winds, millions of dragonflies, literally millions of dragonflies, they fly to India, they'll come here, breed, and then there is a return migration also. That is in with the help of northeast monsoon, that is in October and November. All these dragonflies, again, probably the next generation will fly back to Africa. Interestingly, recently there is a study being published. This dragonfly actually found in US also, it's there in Australia, it's there in Africa. So they collected all this gene pool. They collected their tissue and studied, and they studied the gene pool. Then they realized these dragonflies are actually belong to the same gene pool. So probably when they fly, this dragonfly from Africa to India, they'll be flying from here, India to Australia. I mean, probably when they come back to Africa from there, they may be going to South America. Or I don't know if it's from South America, I mean, but it's there in US. It's going to US and other countries and all across the world. So imagine a tiny insect, which few inches, they actually fly across the globe. It's probably the greatest migration of any insects in the world. And interestingly, I put up a picture of Amur falcon. If you follow Amur falcon's migration, Amur falcon also do the similar migration. They actually come to Nagaland, I mean, hundreds of them, then they fly to Africa to mainly the feeding ground. So they actually follow these dragonflies. So when they fly, dragonflies are their main food. Even the hobbies, they follow this. European beaters, European roller, they follow these dragonflies. We have another very interesting dragonflies all over India. It's called the granite ghost. And interestingly, this, like I already mentioned, that dragonflies lay eggs in the water. They prefer lakes or rivers or stream, freshwater. They prefer freshwater. But this dragonfly, the granite ghost, they actually lay eggs in absolute pure water. We know that the best water what we can get in wherever in the world, it's actually the rainwater. We get the best rain. So this dragonflies actually lay eggs in the rainwater pools, especially on the granite rocks or any well. If you have any well around your house, or you may find this dragonfly around swimming pool, wherever the best water, you may find these dragonflies. And also these dragonflies are the larvae when they lay eggs, that's a larvae down there. And they actually feed mainly on mosquito larvae. We know that monsoon time, we get a lot of diseases, elephantiasis, dengue fever, malaria. All those are spread by a particular mosquito. It's called the Aedes mosquito, which is lays all this kind of water, because they also lay eggs in stagnant water where there's rainwater. And this dragonfly's larvae is known to feed on those mosquito larvae. That's why this is one of the best dragonfly to have around, and they want to protect us from all the diseases. And in Thailand and Japan and all, they actually rear this dragonfly and sell it. It's actually a big market there also. And next time, keep a lookout for this dragonfly. And also in nighttime and all, this dragonfly known to roost in small numbers. I've seen them up to 10, 15 and all, roosting onto a small trees and all. Another interesting dragonflies, you must have seen this dragonfly all over, wherever you've been, next to a stream or a lake. It's called the beach jewel, Brachythemis contaminata. This actually stay next to a rivers or stream. And look at the scientific name. It's actually called the Brachythemis contaminata. So the scientific name, the Latin name means it can survive in contaminated water. So this dragonfly, we've seen them a lot around polluted streams in the cities and all. So it's actually an indication, this dragonfly. And you may not find other dragonflies there, but you may find this dragonfly. So that means the pollution is increasing that area. And be careful, check out your water quality around that area. So, we've seen quite a few times, these dragonflies, this visual stays next to polluted streams and all. But there is a limit to it. Once it gets to too much, the dragonfly larvae won't be able to survive in this kind of habit. So eventually the dragonfly larvae will die. And also, eventually, the mosquitoes number will increase, and we'll get more diseases around us. Okay, another very fascinating dragonfly found in all across India, especially the forested area. It's called the pygmy skimmer. It's there in central India. It's there in South India. It's there in Northeast India. This dragonfly is, like I mentioned, most of these dragonfly lay eggs in the water. They go directly dip the tail into the water, or they sit on the water weeds and lay eggs. But this dragonfly, they are actually known to lay eggs above, they actually breed in stagnant pools, stagnant water puddles or pools. If there is a trees or a branch on the top of this the water puddle, they lay eggs on that. They don't lay eggs in the water directly. So like this, look at this female. Actually, she is laying eggs. These are all eggs here. She is laying eggs onto this branch here. So when she lay eggs, it's actually once the rain start, the eggs actually hatch and the larvae drop directly into the water and they can survive. So the survival rate of this larvae is more here, because if dragonflies started laying eggs in the water directly, there are a lot of other predators. There are fishes there. They'll go and start feeding it. They can feed on this eggs. And so the survival rate is less. So this is one of the amazing behavior we observe this dragonfly. Again, I think most of you have seen this dragonflies. It's called the common clubtail. Next time, go to any lake or a river. This one's preferred large lakes or large water bodies. And very powerful flyer. I remember when I was studying in the school and all, I used to try to catch them. So you should be very careful to catch. If you try to catch the tail, they'll literally bend back and they'll bite you. So I got quite a few bites. So it's most common dragonfly, common clubtail. Another interesting dragonfly, it's called the Emerald Cascade. This dragonfly found in Western Ghat, similar looking species there in Northeast also, is there in Central India, is there in Eastern Ghat. And this dragonfly is known to fly over large streams, especially waterfalls or freshwater streams. You don't find them in any kind of polluted water or stagnant lake. This is strictly restricted to the forest streams. And interestingly, if you look at this waterfall here, can you see all these small bushes and plants and all? There could be some moss and all. So this dragonfly actually known and come here and sit here and deposit the eggs here. And eventually, once it's become a larvae and all, the larvae also known to climb onto this kind of waterfall, small area, this side and all. They climb there, then live there. And eventually, it become an adult dragonfly emerge. Again, this is one of the prettiest damselfly I photographed in Sikkim. Not in Sikkim, it is in Meghalaya, in Khasi Hills. It's called Matrona Basilaris. Very, very, very pretty damselfly. This is the male and this is the female. It's called Matrona Basilaris. There's no common name for this damselfly. And another one, Stream Glory. It's widely distributed in Most of India, it's there in Himalayan foothills, Eastern Himalaya, Western Himalayas, it's there in Northeast India, it's there in Eastern Ghats, it's there in Central India, it's there in Western Ghats. And it is, when once it opened its wing, it's very, very beautiful. And other interesting thing, they always found in the fast flowing streams. We've seen it whenever they want to impress a female. Suppose if the male saw a female sitting next to the stream, next to a rock or something, what this dragonfly does, this dragonfly actually go and fly into the stream. They actually drop into the water and they spread the wings and they start flowing along with the water flow. They start flowing downstream. They actually flow in front of the female and try to impress it. So it's amazing to watch. Another very interesting damselflies, it's called the saffron retail, which only found in Western Ghats. And they are highly seasonal. So quite a few dragonflies, they are highly seasonal. They'll come out after the rains, and only for a few months they live, lay eggs and disappear. Nobody see them after that. So this is one of that damselfly we found it. I still remember quite a few years back, and me and my friend Kiran, we were walking through a forest in Ponmudi southern Western Ghats in Kerala. So Ponmudi, we were walking through a stream, and then checked a stream and walk back to the main road, and there was a small brook, stream was running through the forest. There was no light. Suddenly I thought I saw some blue dot which is flying around. I told Kiran, hey, there is some interesting damselfly thing. Then we found out it's actually a pretty medium size or a large damselfly which is flying around there, which is got a orange or maroon body with the tip of the tail was blue. So we took the photo and we later it's identified. And this is found only on those kind of habitat. Imagine there are small streams in the evergreen forest. So that's where you find them. Again, one of the most prettiest damselfly, if you ask me which is my favorite damselfly, it is this, the Myristica saphir. It's a Western Ghats endemic there. And in Western Ghats, there's a type of forest, it's called the nutmeg forest, nutmeg trees, which is actually got, the roots are like that. So this damselfly is actually found along this kind of Myristica swamps. So that's why the name itself, Myristica saphir. Very pretty damselfly, highly restricted to a few areas, highly seasonal, and prefer to lay eggs in running streams. And very few records. I mean, these days, luckily, there's a lot of people started studying damselflies and dragonflies. That's why you do see them a lot. Again, another interesting dragonfly, which is called the tricolored bloodtail. This dragonfly, again, highly seasonal. It's found in Northeast India. It's there in few pockets of Western Ghats, especially in Silent Valley and all those places. And in deep evergreen forest, if you walk through the forest, just after the rain, you will find these kind of tree holes with the water actually collected in this kind of tree holes. So this dragonfly actually known to lay eggs only in these kind of tree holes. So imagine the micro habitat of this dragonfly. You don't find them throughout the year. You don't find them any streams or rivers or any stream. It's only in evergreen forest and this kind of tree holes. Again, very, very pretty looking damselflies, Kalismia. This one's found in foothills of Himalayas. This is not found in Western Ghats. Those who are living next to Sikkim, Darjeeling, or Northeast India, Assam, foothills, I mean, West Bengal, North Bengal and all, you will be able to see this very, very pretty damselfly. I mean, this one, I think I got it from Baksa or Tiger Reserve. This is from Sikkim. Check out these ones. Again, two species of damselfly. These are all dartlets. The top one is the Kerala dartlet. The below one is the pygmy dartlet. How do you differentiate the Kerala dartlet on the second segment? There's a hood mark of a cobra. Cobra hood mark is here, which is missing in pygmy dartlet. Interestingly, this Kerala dartlet, it's actually restricted to parts of Western Ghats, especially Goa and Kerala and all. It's reported. I'm sure it's there in Karnataka also. And this pygmy dartlet is widely distributed even in most of the Southeast Asian state. It's there in Australia. So one theory says that this dragonfly actually migrated with the help of wind. Imagine there's a big wind current which actually took this damselfly probably from India to Australia and other countries. And where you can find, I mean, if you try to go and find these dam supplies, unless you know where to find it, it's very impossible, very difficult to find it, because these dam supplies are actually known to live among the grasses. Where imagine if there is a water body, and next to the water body, if there is a lot of grass and thick grass and short grass, so you might able to find this dam supplies there. You might have to literally, you know, walk through the grass, then you see these tiny dam supplies flying around. Again, I just showed some more stream jewels across India. They are very pretty, very colorful. Try to photograph wherever you can. So a few more slides are left. I mean, it's almost 5 o'clock, we're reaching. This is actually an interesting dam supply which we are still not able to identify. It's probably a new one, new to science. Quite a few species are yet to be described in India. We need people like you. I mean, we need when you go out into the jungle, or if you are out there in birding. I also started as a birder. I remember many years back when I go out with my binoculars and cameras and all, I used to take pictures of only the birds. So even slowly we turn into butterflies. So I think now it's the time to, we can document the dragonflies, or wherever forest you go, start clicking damselflies. So imagine if you see a damselflies or a dragonfly. So what you have to do is you have to take pictures from all sides. You can get a picture from the friend this time. These are all very key for identifying different species as friend. Try to take a picture from the side angle, from the top level. If it's possible, the tip of the tail, the shape of the anal appendages. All this, if you can get the pictures, it's easy to, we can nail the species. We can identify the species. This is one interesting story I wanted to tell. A few months back, I mean, we have a Facebook page, Dragonflies of India, and also a Dragonflies of Kerala, where we started one thing. We were all locked down past few months, isn't it? Everyone locked up because of COVID, Corona. So we said, why don't you document all your dragonflies around your place and start taking pictures and post it in our Facebook page, and we'll try to help you to identify all the species. So a lot of amazing things happened. I think we recorded over 100 species of dragonflies in Kerala. This was just in Kerala we started. So there was one guy who actually got into dragonflies few months, I mean, not even 1 year back, I think. His name is Reggie from Trivandrum. He actually lives in an amazing place next to foothills of the Agastimalai Tiger Reserve, Agastimalai Biosphere Reserve. So he started photographing dragonflies and damselflies around his place. I mean, he didn't know most of it. So he take pictures and he send it to us. He started posting pictures, and we were all amazed to see. I mean, I think he got around 92 species of different dragonflies behind his house. Luckily, he's living next to a forest. But all this, the top one here, on the top here, this is actually the Myristica saphira, which is, I seen it, I think, only 3 times, which is he saw around 16 of them around behind his house. And another very pretty dragonfly, the lesser blue wing, all these dragonflies behind his house. So he's become a dragonfly freak now. So we want people like you to go out and start document damselflies and dragonflies. We are there to help you out. We have 2-3 Facebook pages and all, we can help. Okay. A few predators for dragonflies. There are spiders and there are birds. But I think ultimately when it's come to the predators and the threats for dragonflies, it's all the people like us. Because all these dragonflies, they are associated to the water, fresh water, streams. Look at this picture down here. This was actually a very good, my friend Vivek took this picture. This was in Kol Wetland in Kerala. It was a very good habitat, but people started, you know, dumping all those waste there. It started reclaiming the land there. Same thing to the right. It was a very good habitat for damselflies. They started putting poison and spraying poison. So eventually all those water weeds died, and eventually all the dragonflies around that area also started disappearing. So these are some of the pictures I just put up here. This species actually found in Western Ghat. I mean, when you go to the forest, you see this amazing dragonfly, which is restricted to only in the forest streams. These dragonflies, you may not see it in the cities or in towns, but if you go to a forest, pristine rivers, you will see this dragonflies and damselflies. But if you come to our cities, our towns, we have started seeing more and more visuals. I hope you remember this visual, because Prakritam is contaminator. It's known to lay eggs in polluted water. They can survive in polluted water. So the moment we started seeing more visuals, that means there's something wrong happening to our place. So I think it's a time to start saving our streams and rivers, start protecting our dragonflies. That is the only way we can actually get away from all this all diseases. I mean, we are all stuck in our home. So I would request all of you to, you know, start studying them or start photographing them, whatever. I mean, we have a few Facebook pages like Dragonflies of India. I mean, if you are from Kerala, you can post in Dragonflies of Kerala groups. So please start observing them, start photographing them, start documenting them around your place. Let's see what we can come up with. I think, thank you so much, all of you. Listen, if you have any questions, we can take some questions. Kavi, Nick, are you guys there?
Thank you, David. That was a fantastic talk. I think now, once we are in the field, we will be able to identify dragonflies and damselflies more easily, and maybe even decide their gender more confidently.
Yeah.
For everyone in the chat, or like everyone in the call, we've opened up the chat box now. So in case you have any questions that you'd like to ask David, you can type them there. And I shall ask them to him, and then David can respond. Meanwhile, we can just make a couple of quick announcements while we have questions coming in. Just give me 1 second. Yep, so like I mentioned earlier, we have another interesting talk coming up tomorrow, which is Life Under the Sea by Vandit Kalia. So he's a diving expert from the Andamans, and he's going to be telling us stories about his diving experiences, as well as the photography he's done of wildlife and animals under the sea. In addition to this, we have a regular feature of our talks has been the question of the day, which is sponsored by our partner Zayas. So I'll just move the slide. David, you can ask all the viewers the question, and the answers will be sent to David, and the best answer will get an opportunity to win either a Zayas binocular harness or a Zayas cleaning kit.
Okay. So this is the question now. Why are dragonflies considered as a bioindicators? I mentioned quite a few things, but if you guys think, if you can add something more, put it in a nice in a small paragraph and send it to us. Because without dragonflies, imagine we will have a lot of trouble around us. So why are dragonflies considered as bioindicators? You can submit your answers in that. Yeah.
Yeah. And you can submit your answers by going to www.delhibirdfoundation.org/contest and giving your details there. And like David mentioned, try to give an entire paragraph, and we will forward those answers to David, and he will select the best answer out of those, and that person will get a prize. Okay, David, we have a lot of questions coming in. Let me start from the top. Just give me 1 second. How many times do dragonflies or damselflies lay eggs in their life cycle?
Okay, so it is a very tricky question to answer. I don't know, actually. This is how many times in their life cycle, because nobody done a proper study of their entire life cycle. How many? Because the big dragonflies, they're known to live for a few months, for 3-4 months and all. It's the small damselflies for a few weeks. So I don't know, actually. So probably I'll get back to this. How many times?
So that's a good place for people to maybe start doing research, and that presents a good opportunity.
Whoever asked that question, I'll come back to you. I'm just saving those messages.
So okay, sure.
I will come back to you on that message. How many times? So I don't know if there is a proper study on this. I don't think there's a proper study. If there is a proper study, I'll come back to you on that. How many times they lay eggs in their life cycle?
Okay. We have Thomas asking, what is a good beginner's guide for dragonflies? So which guides or websites do you recommend, or resources in general that you recommend?
There is a few books actually you can download, which is freely available. One is by Dragonflies of India by Dr. K. Subramanian, which is you can easily download, which is covered quite a few dragonflies. And other thing, Dragonflies of Eastern India by in Orissa and all by Dr. Manoj V. Nair, that is available. And there is a book on dragonflies of Delhi by Nasreen. There's a dragonflies of Kiledov Khana by Mr. Singh. And what else? Any other books? There's one on dragonflies of Kerala, which is partially in Malayalam, so you may not be able to read most of it. And yeah, so but there are a lot of books are coming up. And one website to keep a lookout, indianordinator.org by Shantanu Joshi and Dr. Krishname Kunte, they manage that. It's like I Found Butterflies, similar one. I think they have over 300 species of dragonflies there.
Okay, great. We have a question. Do dragonflies fly backwards as well? And do they also serve as pollinators?
Okay, the first thing, do dragonflies fly backwards? Yes, they do fly backwards. So how does it work? So dragonflies, they have a two pair of wings. So they have four wings. So all these wings, they are actually separated. It's attached to the wing muscles. So they can actually flap the each wings separately. So that's why they can fly in the backwards. They can fly. They can take a 90 degree or a turn. And they can do whatever they want. Other, if you compare to other, like butterflies, they can't flap the wings separately, but dragonflies can do. That's why they can fly back. And do they pollinate? No, actually, unless they actually, dragonflies are not pollinators, unless they, a dragonfly go and sit on the top of a flower and that dragonfly again go back to some other flowers. It's just happened most of the time. It won't happen, but 1% it can happen because they go and sit on the flowers, not to feed any honey and all, but to just to perch.
Got it. We're getting a few questions on, do adult frogs and fish predate on dragonfly larvae?
Oh, yeah, they do.
Okay, so they are a part of their food chain then.
Yeah. But this big dragonfly larvae, they also feed on tadpoles, because when I used to rear them, I used to collect these dragonfly larvae and kept on rearing them. So I used to collect all these tadpoles, frog tadpoles, and feed them. So dragonfly larvae do feed the frog tadpoles also.
Okay. We're getting a few questions on, if you could just highlight the average lifespan of dragonflies and damselflies.
Okay. So there is two ways to look into this dragonfly lifespan. One is their adult stage and the larval stage. So the moment they lay eggs, after a few days or a week or something, they become a larvae. So the larvae known to spend a few weeks to month. Damselflies are not few weeks to some months they spend in the water. And some of the dragonflies, few years, like I mentioned that the relic dragonfly which found in the foothills of Himalaya, there some studies say they live in the water for 11 years, 10, 11 years. And most of these large dragonflies, 1 or 2 years, they live in the larval stage. So once become an adult, they fly for a few months, 2-3 months. If it's a smaller damselfly, for a few weeks into a month. And interestingly, another interesting thing I observed, in central India and all, you notice the temperature goes up to pretty harsh. Even in Delhi also, most of these streams, or if there is a small lake and all, most of these lakes will dry out. So what these dragonflies do, these big dragonflies and all, Anax indicus and all, they go and start injecting their eggs inside a reeds. So reeds actually got inside the reeds, actually got a kind of a bit of water thing. After a few weeks in hot summer days, even the reed also will die out. But once rains started raining in monsoon time, so these dragonflies actually hatch out and start coming out. Yeah, they have a mechanism to emerge. Yes.
Okay. Maybe we'll just take the last couple of questions. Yeah. We have one about, you mentioned that there is a migratory species of dragonfly. Yeah. Do we have any data or information on how much time it takes for a dragonfly to migrate from Africa to India?
Okay, I would suggest, I mean, all of you can, there is an amazing TED talk, instead of I'm explaining in 1 or 2 minutes, there's an amazing TED talk by Dr. Charles Anderson. If you go to YouTube, you can watch that entire series, I think around 18, 19 minutes talk. He explained everything about their lives, how many days they spend. I think it's within a week or something, they actually flies across. Actually, they're flying with the help of this trade winds. It's a tropical, the trade winds. So they are, they fly almost a kilometer up there in the sky. So please do watch his talk, and yeah, it'll be amazing.
Sure. Maybe we could just put the link for that up on the Delibird page also. So if anyone wants to refer to that talk, they can.
I also put up my email ID if anybody want to.
Sure. Do you want to present your screen, or you can just put it in the chat?
I'll put it in the chat box.
Yep. I think another question related to migration is, before migration, do these dragonflies also store food? And what is their main food? So is it like, maybe if you could just compare them in a sense to birds, because birds before migration start feeding up and putting on weight for the migration journey. So do dragonflies also do something similar?
No, they don't have to, because when they fly over the ocean, they actually feed on all these tiny insects. No? So, and also within a week or two, they'll reach in Africa with the help of these winds. So they don't have to feed, I think. And on the way itself, they'll be feeding. But luckily, all these Amur falcon and other birds, they'll be feeding on these dragonflies.
Yeah. Great. Thank you so much, David. It was a really fantastic talk. We really enjoyed it. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. And we hope to see you all tomorrow at 5 p.m. for the talk with Vandit. Thank you so much.
Thank you
so much.
Have
a good evening.
Thank you.